We're now talking to Jeff Malaihollo. He's the chief executive of Central China Goldfields. Jeff, thanks very much indeed for joining us today.
Thank you.
You've had a very busy time in the last few months. You've come out of China, you're renaming your company, and you're repositioning yourselves in Australia and Indonesia. Firstly, why Australia? Many people say it's a very expensive place to be mining.
Yes, thanks very much. You're correct, we are busy. We go to where the opportunities are. When we saw Bullabulling, we thought that could be a company maker. So we went to Bullabulling on that basis. Bullabulling was a producing mine up to 1998. 1998, of course, gold price is down at 350. Gold price now is about $1,200 an ounce. So we think we could make a go at it.
So why Bullabulling? I mean, did nobody else look at it? It obviously was on the radar and on the map, and nobody else looked at it. What was so attractive about it?
Three reasons why we went to Bullabulling. The first one is that there's 430,000 ounces of gold already defined, JORC compliance, Australian standard compliance. Nice thing about that is those ounces are literally underneath the pit. So it's within the pit, and basically when people were mining it, they stopped mining it and left it underneath the pit. So again, with the gold price going up at 1200, we think we can make a go at that. So that's the first reason. The second reason is that we also noticed that when there is some drilling underneath, it's only about 50 meters depth, there's some fantastic intersection, 7 meters at 77 gram, 12 meters at 9 grams. And the nice thing about it is that we notice that these are distributed all along the 6 kilometers land that we have in Bullabulling. So we think there's something more interesting underneath that, and underneath the oxide pits, the shallow material. And the third thing is that when we saw the 430,000 ounces, it's mainly measured and indicated resource. There's very little inferred, and that's very unusual, because mostly it's inferred and very little measured and indicated. Which begs the question, where's the rest of it? And then we saw that there's 12,000 drill holes. So we think, hang on, there must be something out there. And that's what we've done.
But if it is such a massive opportunity, why go 50-50 in a joint venture with AusEx? And why not go alone and keep it all for yourself?
Yeah. Well, AusEx actually have the option. And they have the option in the beginning of this year. At that time, they don't have the money to do it. We've got the money coming out of China. We sold our assets in China. And that's why we're coming into that opportunity.
Well, they are currently raising 3.7 million Aussie dollars extra cash to cover all this, the exploration. As you just mentioned, is the money coming from China enough to cover your part of it, and for how long?
Yes. We still got about £2.1 million. We've already publicly stated that to bring Bullabulling into the end of feasibility will cost us $2.5 to $3 million Australian dollars. Because we own 50%, we're only up for half of it. So $1.5 million Aussie dollars, roughly £1 million. So yes, we have enough money.
And what is the current cash burn? I mean, we talked originally about how expensive it might be in Australia. Mm. What's the cash burn?
The corporate and G&A cash burn is roughly £30,000 to £40,000 pounds a month. But on top of that, obviously, there's the drilling costs, etc., which already mentioned is about $2.5 to $3 million Aussie dollars altogether.
So when's the next key date for this particular site in terms of the feasibility studies? When's production about to start? What's the calendar?
We said that the feasibility will be finished hopefully in about 12 to 18 months' time. So by the end of 2011, we should, middle or towards the end of 2011, we should be able to finish feasibility. And on the back of that, we probably need about 6 months to build the mine.
Now, you're also, of course, in Indonesia, and you've said you've been looking at acquisitions. How would you finance those if all the money that you've currently got is tied up with Australia?
Sure. In fact, we dropped a project in Indonesia recently, but that's an example of how we do it. In Indonesia, what we did is we have an option over a project, and we'd spend about $75,000 in it. And at the end of it, in particular with a few of Bullabulling, we don't feel that it's worth pursuing that particular opportunity. But the idea here is that you use the money in central China to do the due diligence and perhaps the initial bit of investment. But the project has to be robust enough to stand by itself, and then it can be funded by itself.
Do you have any other opportunities at the moment? Then?
Yes, we are still looking at quite a lot of opportunities, but we're, now again, with Bullabulling in back being the major project of the company now, we have to be a bit more careful in terms of which project we want to pick up.
Now, you made a pre-tax loss of £500,000 last year. When do you aim to be profitable? What investors are basically looking for profit on companies. When's the planned profit side of things?
Again, with most exploration and development company, mining company, will be in the loss. And the point of profitability is when we start putting the mine into production. So again, we're looking at about 2 years time frame.
Okay. Final quick question: an Australian listing, is that a possibility? Is that
definite
an option?
Possibility.
Within what sort of time frame?
We're exploring all that possibilities at this stage.
Okay, Jeff Malaihollo, thank you very much indeed for joining us today.
Thank you.